Hello, 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 everybody, and welcome back to your VP game coverage here. I'm Durka in the joinDOTA studios, and we've had one series already. DK and VGP going 1-1, a win apiece. Pretty good performance by both teams. No rares won, no rares lost. But this game, what have we got in store for us? Terrorblade against newb.y. Terrorblade, I'd say, have done decently. newb.y. still yet to prove themselves as a strong, solid squad, but they've got the talent. It's just the tactics that I think they need to work on. But let's see. Oh, XSplit, you've done it again. Hello! There's the camera shot. For some reason, XSplit got stuck on the waiting screen. But hi, guys. Welcome. Welcome, everyone. Now we can head back into the draft, actually. And welcome in, Scant. How are you doing?
I'm doing all right. Yeah, I think that both Terrorblade and newb.y got a tie from their first series in this tournament. So,
like everyone else.
Yeah, like basically everyone else. I think DK got a 2-0 over the third newbie team. But other than that, yeah, all just ties. But yeah, Terrorblade was the team that we saw yesterday with a pretty good game one. Well, that was that really sort of epic feeling game one against Dream Gaming that went back and forth and back and forth. In the end, they won with their PL. And then game two with the offlane morphling, they just looked totally lost and didn't work for them at all. And actually, yeah, newb.y banning out the PL in the second ban phase here. So having done their research and probably having followed the matches yesterday.
Yeah, don't see why not. Terrorblade with the first 1-2 of Phoenix and Earthshaker, while newb.y going for the Lion and Sniper. Shadowfiend and Storm banned out. No Queen of Pain, though. Not touched whatsoever yet. Maybe now newb.y think about picking it up, but I'm not too sure. When you're against an Earthshaker especially, that long-range Fissure to catch you from Fog and then follow up from whatever Terrorblade pick up as their last three picks, it can be a little bit scary. Picking up, a pretty squishy hero that's quite immobile, and they go the opposite way, opposite end of the spectrum. A mobile hero in Nightstalker, very quick during the nighttime, but tanky is all hell very early on.
Where will Nightstalker go? Because in the West, we've actually seen a lot of support in offlane Nightstalker recently. I don't know. Have we seen that in China, or is it still just a mostly mid hero in China?
I have no idea. I actually haven't seen Nightstalker picked up in China. I don't think. I've not seen it myself. I'm not sure if it's a popular hero at all. But yeah, over in CIS, it's definitely like a four-role hero. In some of the sort of Western European teams, it's been run as an offlaner. I'm not sure at all. But mobile in the night, pretty tanky. He's like top five of effective HP heroes in the early game, definitely. High armor, high starting HP. What is it? He starts with 5 armor and 700 HP, something like that. It's pretty nuts.
And another question I have to ask. So newb.y picking the Nightstalker, we don't really see in China much. Terrorblade banned Ember Spirits against them. And it's actually, I wrote an article recently for Elite Mag about some heroes that have disappeared from the metagame, and I can't see why they have, and Ember Spirit was one that I mentioned, because this was by very, very far the most picked core hero in China leading into DAC, mm-hmm. And then suddenly at that tournament, they weren't picking it. I mean, literally, till the day before DAC, Chinese matches was like Ember every game, Ember every game, Ember every game. And then at the tournaments, like, I don't know if the Western teams at that LAN figured something out or something, but the Chinese teams have just, ever since that tournament, during and after, just deprioritized the Ember Spirits. We still see it here and there. But it went from being in every game to being in hardly any games, and seeing it banned is refreshing for me. It means that there's at least one team here, newb.y, which clearly likes to play with it still.
Yeah, it's one of those heroes that we also used to see a lot banned out in Southeast Asia, picked there as well. You know, CSW is the big team that comes to mind whenever they played. I always used to see Ember Spirit banned against them, and I think it comes down to the popularity of Sniper and heroes like Juggernaut that just do not care about Flame Guard. You know, their physical damage just bypasses it completely. But they also have ways to deal with it. With Blade Fury and Shrapnel, Assassinate, they can basically dissipate that Flame Guard with one fell swoop. But also the fact that Ember Spirit is pretty good at defending high ground, but he needs a lot more items than other heroes being picked up.
Yeah, I guess that makes sense. Still, I feel like as good as Sniper is against Ember, Ember's also pretty good at gap closing against Sniper. So, but yeah, I mean, let's not spend the whole draft talking about Ember Spirit. The Queen of Pain does finally get picked up, which I think these days that's kind of like, it's almost where Ember Spirit was. Like, the draft's not going to go the whole way through without seeing a ban or pick on Queen of Pain. Mm-hmm. It's just everywhere in China right now. And there are some Western teams that have started prioritizing it, but in China in particular, we just see tons of Queen of Pain, and unless it gets banned. And about half of the time now, we also see that Shadowblade pick up on the Queen of Pain, which I find very exciting. Not usually on the mid Queen of Pain, which this one looks like, but we did see one earlier in the previous series on a mid Queen of Pain.
Yeah, it's pretty fun to watch. Now, Terrorblade do have the option here to run Phoenix as an offlaner or as a support. So their last pick will, I don't think it will really show their hand fully, but it will definitely give some idea to newb.Y where they'll be running their lanes. Earthshaker... as well, they could be running this ES Phoenix offlane that we've seen from IG occasionally. You know, you've mentioned it where Luo has the ES or Tidehunter or Axe, one of those offlane heroes that can either go back into the jungle or make things happen in other lanes. Well, the Phoenix does actually go off towards the offlane and they do pick up the Tide.
So it will be support Phoenix then, right? Yeah, Sparrow is a support player.
Yeah.
And it's kind of cool that the guy called Sparrow plays Phoenix. It seems like fitting. But... that does mean that they're probably running a sort of safe tri lane. I guess the Earthshaker will roam a bit. We don't see support Phoenixes that often playing that role. Normally when they're picked up, they move around, they help the offlane. And I guess in this game, when the Tidehunter goes off to farm stacks, the Phoenix will then transition into the offlane probably. Because usually the support Phoenix wants to get those levels and get the ulti up sort of sooner rather than later.
Well, the last pick, Skyrath, was kind of a pick up against that Phoenix, but now it's switched around. Nice Stalker, I'm going to be keeping a close eye on this guy. Boots first with an Observer Ward, so he's heading off to the offlane. 4-5-6, Night Stalker. Let's see what he can do up there while we've got Murr. And that is what I've resorted to calling him, by the way, guys. I'm not going to call him M-triple-R, I'm calling him Murr. MK on the Lion, Skyrath Mage behind him, Piao playing the Sniper, and then our final hero. S-triple-C. I don't have the luxury of calling him by a shorter name. It's just, I don't know. We'll find a way. He's on the Axe, though. While over in the Dire, we have the Happy Face guy over in Tidehunter. While mid lane, Whitewash, the support Earthshaker, moving around. They've got the Queen of Pain, played by Xiao Xiao. Sparrow on the Phoenix, like you called out. And HM playing the safe lane one roll Juggernaut. Tide gets spotted out down on this bot lane, while Lion tries to get a couple of clicks in there. But it's not too difficult for the Tide just to walk himself away. He's got plenty of tangos, plenty of regen. The only difficult thing is for him placing that Observer Ward.
I think you just make an angry cat sound, like some kind of
so we've
hissing
got,
noise.
We've got brrr, the cat purring, and then we've got the cat being angry.
Yeah, so that's...
newb.Y has a couple of cat sounds on their team.
Well, by the way, did you see that the Axe... wrote S4 on the minimap?
Yes,
what's that about?
I did see it, and I don't know. I'm not sure.
Oh man, I gotta reconnect. There's some big lag here.
Oh boy. Sparrow blocking up mid lane, allowing Xiao Xiao to get that bounty run up top, while Piao on the sniper takes the one mid. So both supports blocking for their mid player. So it's Queen of Pain against Sniper. This matchup is really skill dependent. The Queen of Pain can win out. Support rotations matter a lot. You know, Skyrath Mage can harass down the Quab, so Sniper gets that early momentum built up. With the Queen of Pain getting herself some early tangos, Sniper and Quab pretty much have mirrored builds right now here. Null on one, Wraithband on the other, tangos shared and tangos bought for each of our mids. Whitewash on this top lane, support Earthshaker. Looking to block in 4-5-6. I think this is a game where you go level 2 Blade Fury on the Juggernaut, right?
Yeah, it probably is, because there's going to be kills to make with that, and there might not be kills to make without it. For now, the Fissure Block is not... Maybe with the Phoenix coming in? Yeah, maybe that...
Did that
he
land?
Actually gets it.
Oh, the Fissure animation was really slow. They've got the block off, and 4-5-6 now is in a pretty rough situation. Has to buy a TP and try. He doesn't have time. He doesn't have the HP pool to do it. First Blood will go the way of Terrorblade here onto that offlane Night Stalker, with Juggernaut taking the last hit. Securing that kill and giving himself a nice little boost of gold.
It's a really nice Fissure Block. It looked like he had lost the angle, and he went for the sort of much steeper, bigger gradient, and it worked, actually. Kind of surprising for me, but really well done, I think. You were mentioning in the draft, looking at the other offlane, that, you know, maybe switching Phoenix from offlane to support when they see the Skyrath, but Skyrath is really good at zoning a Tidehunter as well. Tidehunter, which struggles to get zoned by normal right clicks, but... by Skyrath Mage, it can get zoned all day.
Interesting then that Skyrath has gone Concussive Shot first. No Arcane Bolt to spam out, so they want to try and slow him down, allow the Axe to get in there. Axe is a decent hero 1v1 against Tide, so the option is definitely there for MK and Murr to move around, especially with this... Oh. he waiting for the courier? Oh, they know he's there. They know he's there. Dark Observer will spot him out. Xiao Xiao not going to give away his courier for this. In fact, looking at the last hits, Queen of Pain's a little bit behind. The sniper gets boots and the Quap still saving for bottle.
Yeah, so, I mean, I sort of think Queen of Pain can win this lane by last hitting. But if you look at her build, she's gone for the 2 points in Shadow Strike, the normal build, and I think that that's how Queen of Pain goes behind in this lane.
Fisher block up at top. Whitewash is coming in. They've got the Phoenix rotating as well. They just want to wait for 4-5-6 to put himself into a position where he will get blocked out. But I think that because the creep wave has hit tier 1, Juggernaut's on low HP, they won't go for it.
Yeah, and he's too far away, so even with the Phoenix and the Ears, they're not going to be able to kill the Nightstalker. But yeah, going back to that mid lane, I sort of feel like Queen of Pain's trying to win this lane with the Shadow Strike board, with the harassment. That's how they actually lose this lane. I think you just use the, you know, nice attack animation, nice attack time, high base damage, and just last hit. Never get affected by Shrapnel because you can blink or walk out of it quite easily. So yeah, I wasn't watching right at the start, but I put the difference down to, if I just look at the Queen of Pain's board, that's probably what she was trying to do initially and probably how she went behind.
The big thing about Shadow Strike though is that it preps you for the blink scream sonic wave. And that's why I get this feeling you need it. You know, it burns through the sniper's regen so he doesn't get too ballsy and, you know, get up onto your ramp and deal with you that way. So even if it doesn't win you the lane, it makes sure you don't lose the lane. And then it sets you up for later on when you Shadow Strike him, you let him tick over to, you know, 80% HP or something like that. Drop him down to 520 health. And then you jump in with the Scream Sonic Wave and finish him off.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, Shadow Strike always useful for a position where the other guy can't just man up and fight you, but I just think early on in this lane, that's exactly what the sniper can do. So having the skill points will definitely help, but trying to make good use of them early on, I think it can be counterproductive at times.
Did you notice actually over on the Dire side, the Ancients have been blocked up by a Sentry Ward, so Tidehunter has no route back in.
Yeah, I mean, he'll find somewhere to farm eventually, but it's not going to be early on in the game, that's for sure. You know, eventually they'll be able to stack Ancients, or maybe even just regular jungle camps. But yeah, you're right, he's going to be weak at the start, and in the meantime, there's some... Wait, are there stacks being made in the Radiant jungle? I thought there would be, there aren't actually. Usually when we see the safe lane axe, there's some stacks being made for him. He's getting pretty, like, farmed anyway, so if he wants to rush the Vanguard or the Blink, he'll have it soon. But I'm a little bit surprised that Lion hasn't been making stacks, because I think Skyrath can do the zoning on his own.
Yes, they've been controlling runes a lot, they've been moving around. The Skyrath did go to mid once with that haste, just to try and, you know, spot out the bottle if it was coming. But first Knight has hit, 4-5-6 on this Nightstalker, with 1 point in that silence. They're looking for it. Xiao Xiao, he's going to blink now! He does get away, and 4-5-6 doesn't get the silence out. Shrapnel's going to be super annoying. Does Assassinate finishes him here, doesn't it? Yep. Queen of Pain goes down. The vision from the Shrapnel allowing Piao to find that little angle, the tiny bit of vision he needed to find that kill. And now Nightstalker, one versus one against Whitewash. That blocks him out, though. While down a bot lane, Tidehunter does get dropped by the Lion, Skyrath, and Axe.
Yeah, and Lion justifying not making stacks. If he can be there and be involved in kills, that's definitely worth it. The Shrapnel also dealt quite a lot of damage there. I think the Queen of Pain wasn't low enough initially to assassinate, so... Everything adding up there, and the Nightstalker just having to run in and chase the Queen of Pain down to a position where a sniper knew he could shrapnel. Even though the Nightstalker didn't actually get any spells off, assisting in that kill, I think, because the Queen of Pain didn't have time to decide where do I blink so that I won't get shrapneled and assassinated, just like blinking straight away.
Well, now both teams are making stacks. Earthshaker tried, but it looks like he failed somehow, while the Lion did succeed down on his large camp in the Radiant Jungle. That's kind of interesting. I thought Earthshaker did that fine. Huh.
At the big camp?
Yeah, the big camp. He was pulling it across. He even got his clarity cancelled by the centaur.
Yeah, because it's melee creeps, you'd expect he would be able to do it fine. Sometimes the range creeps when you pull as a melee hero are a bit harder. But he shouldn't have difficulty with the centaurs.
Well, Tidehunter now, no sentry at his ancient, so he'll start getting some stacks up. Piao at this mid lane, what are we looking at last hit-wise? Juggernaut, 41 for 16. But then you've got a 38 and 31 Axe and Sniper, the Queen of Pain, getting almost doubled up on here by the Sniper in mid. And so, Nightstalker. Nightstalker's hunting. They've got an Observer Ward spotting him out every step of the way, though. Queen of Pain backs up. Earthshaker is ready here in the background. They could think about baiting out, but But now that
the war,
you know,
just shows everything.
Yeah, Lion shows himself. It's a little bit too risky.
Yeah, it's. Oh wow! Look at that deep ward by Lion. Does that ward show both towers?
We can find out.
It shows
the tier two, but it does just barely show that tier one. Yeah, it does.
Alright, so a very useful ward there then. We'll always spot out the ES in those positions, and it's also going to help the sniper get those assassinates off.
Oh, Tide.
If there's a fight and Queen of Pain blinks away.
Oh, Tide. He's going to do a decent job of surviving the Kraken shell, you know, Anchor Smash getting thrown out, but in the end, SCCC gets the Culling Blade down and dunks him out.
Is he going for the blink? He's going for the blink. Often in a safe lane, we see Axe getting the Vanguard first, and then it secures the blink anyway when he goes to farm the stacks. But I guess he figures he can go for some kills right now. For me, that's what the blink would indicate. That you don't want to farm a whole lot before you go for kills. And they're going straight mid.
Yeah, they're taking ancients on. Oh? The Observer Ward spots them out so they know exactly... Well, TB know exactly where they're coming from. Oh, look at that! Whitewash realizes, hang on. If they're going this deep, they must have some intel that we don't know about. We can see them moving in. And they can apparently see us. So Whitewash with the Great Sentry dropped there. Oh, I was kind of expecting Radiant just to go into the Ancients. Take that up with the Axe. But with this Blink Dagger already revealed, Battle Hunger onto the smiley face. Tidehunter, does he get caught in the call? He does indeed. But two TPs reacting, coming in. Sparrow, stunned up. And it looks like Newbee.Y will try and back out. But Xiao Xiao is here. Shadow Strike and Fiery Spirits. The Dot is killing him. And MK drops.
Yeah, and getting the kill that justifies the TPs, because otherwise it would have been a pretty bad set of TPs to have baited out. In the meantime, the Juggernaut actually still gets the top tower. Nightstalker was trying to deny it, but didn't actually succeed in doing that.
Yeah, it's getting a little bit funny up there. HM turned to fight, dropped to about 200 HP after the Void. You know, he had Mask of Madness to go, right-clicking him down, but 456 was just standing in the creep wave. If he had chased and, you know, got himself away from those allied creeps, then Omnislash comes out and takes him out. But 456, well aware
of what's
going on.
Axe smoked.
Smoked up, Link, Call, Xiao Xiao, Assassinated. This will be his death as Culling Blade seals the deal. Phoenix tried to go for the big supernova, but Omnislash, across so many heroes at level 1, doesn't really do that much. Axe is left to clean up and pick up the scraps. They do get a couple of decent kills in exchange, and overall... Terrorblade lose two supports in the Queen of Pain. Killing the Axe, you know, is decent. His first big Blink Dagger usage makes a couple of kills. Overall, relatively even, though.
It was a great moment in that fight where Earthshaker was running into three enemies, and I was thinking, is he going to Echo Slam? And then I'm like, oh, he's level 2.
Level 2.
Would have been a great Echo Slam moment.
Oh well. Skarath, actually, let's take a look at hero levels. Level 2 on the Earthshaker, he is down in the dumps while you've got a 5 on Lion, 5 on Skarath. A couple of heroes on level 6, the Phoenix, we just saw a Supernova, Tidehunter, did not ravage in that fight, didn't get the opportunity to do so. Sniper level 9, Juggernaut up there as well. Here comes a smoke in though. Terrorblade, Fish to start, Queen of Pain blinks forward, and Sonic Wave. It drops Piao down with the help of Fiery Spirits. That's a pretty quick and easy kill. No response from Newbee.Y, as they're still stacking up, taking camps.
And that's the kill they wanted to make. It's the kill they hadn't made yet. They hadn't killed the sniper yet. The sniper was doing really, really well and going for that glass cannon bullet, and immediately they kill him, punishing him for it.
Well, taking a look at net worth, Tide is going to make a little jump here. Stacking up Ancients once again. He's got a double stack, three camps already in waiting for him. Juggernaut, please. Please don't steal these from your Tide. He needs Blink. He needs Arcanes. He needs Mech. Whatever he's going to go for. In fact, what do you expect from him here?
The Tidehunter... I don't expect Arcanes. The Blink or Mech, probably Blink.
That's the thing. Because he saved up over 1,000 gold, he got to 1,200, you don't expect Arcanes, and then extrapolating from that, you kind of think, okay, well, without Arcanes, it's very unlikely he's going for Mech. So, I'm with you with the Blink Rush.
Yeah, and they kind of, it feels like there's an urgent need, the way these fights are going to work, for sort of counter initiation to be as lightning quick as the initiation. And if you look at the other side, the Axe is a blink, the Nightstalker is super fast, Shrapnel can get you from anywhere. So I think they'll feel the orb, Tide dies.
No, he was saving up so well, but Axe comes in with a smoke, Scarf Mage helping him out.
Do you see that? As he died, he bought a bracer. So, don't know about him. Well, he sold it. He sold it. Interesting. Yeah, because... Oh, now he bought it again. Look at that.
That can't have been efficient. Because he had... Yeah. He had 1,500 gold. And he would have lost... Oh, I wish I checked the flight recap now just for this. He had 1,500 gold. He would have lost about 200 or so from dying. Yeah, death cost 210. So he lost... He went down to 1,300. When did he buy the bracer? Before he died?
Yeah, right before he died, he bought the bracer. And then he died, and then he sold it. I think in that 10-second period, probably. And then bought it again. So he might not have lost extra gold. And then he buys the wonders he spawns, so he's decided he's not actually rushing any big item. They'll win a fight first somehow, and then he'll go for it. Well, maybe he'll farm another stack before he gets there.
Okay.
But yeah, it could be a problem. That's what I was discussing beforehand, that the speed of initiation from the Radiant side is not really matched by the Dire side. They've got the long-range Fissure, and I guess that's going to have to be their sort of trump card for letting the Phoenix get ulti off, for letting the Tide get ulti off. And even letting the Juggernaut run in, and Juggernaut TP's in, they're looking to fight, so this is going to be a 5v5 fight.
Shrapnel goes down though, there's no way to get in there. Assassinate under the Tidehunter, just making sure he's too low to run in and ravage, and Terrorblade, they just back themselves up. There's farm to be had top, their entire jungle is uncontested, and pretty ripe for the picking. They've still got that large cap stacked up, actually. I've been wondering this entire time, who takes the stacks? Axe has taken a fair amount of them, but this large one over here, Nightstalker does not have any clearing abilities. Sniper can decently, with a Mask of Madness, you know, just take him down slowly but surely. Axe, do you need it on him?
Well, you know, there's a snowballing axe gets better and better for all his items, so it's not bad. I think he goes there now, probably. I'm not sure. Does he? No, he doesn't. Okay. I like that movement by Terrorblade, by the way. Seeing the Juggernaut TP down bots and the enemy team's looking for 5v5, just like, okay, well, now we'll TP out. We'll get value all over the place, and They could probably still go back and defend if they really want to. Although it looks like they're going to opt for the split push. And the amount of value they've gained in the last minute or two while... I said the wrong team. Newbee. The amount of value that Newbee's gained in the last minute or two while Terrorblade have been 5-manning down that lane has been quite a lot, actually. They've been getting farm on lots of heroes in lots of places, pushing multiple lanes.
Oh yeah, the trades they're getting are very worthwhile. Actually, Lion was down on the spot lane looking to leech some experience and... You know, build himself up, maybe get a few last hits while he was at it. Pink came out though from his Skarath Mage companion saying, "Hey dude, they're all missing. They're probably still down at their bot lane." So Lion backs up. They don't get a kill for their efforts. Terrorblade anyway, down on this bot lane. While MK, maybe now is his time to die. Axe walks into Tide. They just sort of brush past each other and nothing happens of it. So observer ward wise, what are we looking at? Radiant with a pretty aggressive one here in the Dire jungle. The Dire though. They've got an interesting aggressive ward in the enemy jungle, looking for that movement in with Queen of Pain and Earthshaker. Juggernaut, you know, he's level 11. The level 2 Omnislash can definitely go into these open areas and make things happen. But smoke up from Newbee. They found Tide again. Oh, with a Mystic Flare and Call, there's just no chance whatsoever. His Blink is getting pushed further and further back.
I mean, he was down to like 300 last time he spawned. He went back all the way up to 1,300 and loses another 300 or 400 gold there. And he still hasn't been able to cast Ravage this entire game, I think.
Yeah, it's been a little rough for him. Silence from Nightstalker is ready. Pretty good ability to have up against this Phoenix. Just stop him from Supernova also. You know, mentioning the Quap. What is the duration? Is it 4 or 5 seconds? 5 seconds scaling, 1 second per level on that. On that crippling fear.
I think the one weakness for newb.young at the moment is the Sniper's Super Glass Cannon build. I think there's a lot of potential for him being picked off, and it weakens them a lot if that happens. I don't know if you've noticed, but so the player I think in the West has been playing Sniper the best and the most lately is PyCat, and
yes.
He's sort of adapted his Glass Cannon build. He tempers it a bit. He starts the phase, he'll get the Morbid Mask, but he won't finish Mask of Madness, and then he'll start his S&Y but with the Sand, not with the Yasha, which I think is really nice. I think that's like a nice way to temper it a bit. Doing this full on, finish the Mask of Madness and get the Yasha first, really does open the possibility of you being killed despite having so much farm. You know, the Queen of Pain's got like 3,000 less net worth, but she could kill the Sniper.
Oh yeah, definitely. There's that other build as well from Sniper that we sometimes see, you know, Trez Bracer, if you really are super worried about the magic nuke coming from your opponents, but I do agree. PyCat with the middle ground kind of thing, you know. building up slowly but surely into the strength rather than the agility too early on, because early, Mask of Madness gives you more than enough attack speed, your headshot gives you plenty of damage, and if you've got some buffs on your team, then why not?
So, while we're chatting, Terrorblade took the rush. Aegis on Juggernaut, but Axe has just got his Crimson Guard as well. I don't know which of those pickups is a bigger deal if a fight breaks out soon. I want to say the Crimson Guard actually matters more than the Aegis. I'm not sure though.
I think Terrorblade's positioning matters more than like their item pickups and things like that. If the Juggernaut can go in and do some serious damage initially, then pop back to life, then the rest of his team sort of swarms around with Fissure, Ravage, the Supernova as well. The only one item I'm looking ahead from Terrorblade is Blink on Tide.
Yeah, that's what they're waiting for before they fight, I think. Although they did move towards the bot lane earlier, looking like they might want a 5v5, but since then they haven't actually gone for anything like that, and Fadanta is getting close to his dagger, and then that'll make their positioning a lot easier in fights, and as you say, that is quite crucial. They've got a really strong 5v5 lineup if they do position well. In fact, their lineup's actually a stronger 5v5 lineup, I would say.
Yeah.
It's just that they're currently behind in terms of gold and position and, you know, the momentum's on the side of newb.young at the moment.
Like, if Terrorblade can position themselves around an objective and not get caught out, good blink from Xiao Xiao. Pretty fast on the fingers there. But if Terrorblade can position themselves around an objective or be the ones that are looking to fight, rather than newbie, you know, smoking up, catching them off guard, because that's where newbie's strength is right now. Finger of Death, Call, Culling Blade, Night Stalker charging you down. Every single one of their heroes really is looking for that quick and easy kill. You go in, find a pick, and then take the team fight afterwards. Find the one-man advantage, just to get one up on your opponents. Whereas Terrorblade, like you said, their magic damage, their AoE, disables and everything, it's a lot stronger. So fighting around Roshan, fighting around especially tier 1 towers in these sort of narrow choke points, ramps up into the jungle, then they could definitely make things work for themselves.
I mean, Phoenix ulti, if it lasts the full duration in a fight, usually wins the fight, and I think combined with the Ravage and the Fissure, it really very possibly could, never mind the threat of the Queen of Pain and Juggernaut DPSing. So it is a scary team fight lineup they have there. We say the Tide's nearly got Dagger, but you know Lion actually also nearly has Dagger. And so both teams getting better at what they're good at doing at this point in time. The pick-up potential is going to become even bigger for newb.young, but the team fight potential is going to become even bigger for Terrorblade.
Well, now they've got the Blink Dagger on Tide. The line has been drawn. Terrorblade wants to move down towards this mid lane. They will start posturing around the tier 1 here. SCC, he sees the Juggernaut. He's getting ready to blink in. The creep wave has moved off, though, so the timing's not quite there. And HM will head into the trees. He's still got Aegis Immortal, so he'll look to bait this out a little bit. The rest of his team are swarming in. And this is it. This is the concave you want. You've got heroes starting to prep themselves for, you know, Juggernaut just walks in here, starts hitting the tower. The rest of the team. Oh, well, those are pings from Orange. MK calling out, they're going to be waiting. They're going to be ready. Mana drain onto the illusion. Shrapnel, here's the Ravage on 3. Supernova as well. Sonic Wave, that's the teamfight TB wanted. Taken down 2, not quite killing that Night Stalker. A little bit too tanky. One more swipe, one more hit from anybody would have finished him off.
Yeah, but that's... See, if a fight starts like that, it's just difficult to imagine newb.young ever winning it, to be honest. And so, they need to be positioned better so that they can't all get caught by the same AoE. Or they need to just constantly be making pickoffs, so the enemy team's not all alive, and Axe is going to be chased.
Oh, he gets the call, the Mystic Flare drops, Phoenix here, Culling Blade, something, anything, yeah, they'll find it, but Axe is the counter kill for them. 4-5-6, where are you going, buddy? You're walking into 4 here, you do have Sniper backing you, you do have Skywrath backing you up, not Sniper. But he's not really the hero that provides a lot when you're 2v4.
Yeah, and this, I don't know, it's starting to look like Clash of Styles where the one style just beats the other one. You know, the strong teamfight versus the strong pickoff, I think teamfights is just generally stronger unless the pickoff lineup is really, really snowballing hard. And sure, it's only one fight, and we might see something different in the following fights. It's also, even though Terrorblade have a stronger team fighting lineup, I think that if the initiation comes from the other side, if Axe gets a nice call into Skywrath ulti or Finger of Death, and an important hero gets burst on for newb.young, they could still win a fight. I mean, it's harder for them to win a fight, but they definitely can. Mm-hmm. But that fight was an example of how we sort of expect the average fight to maybe go as the game progresses. And that's why team fights are not going to generally favor newb.y, I would say.
Now, when I was making the point, you know, Terrorblade will be looking to group up around towers, especially getting into these choke points. I didn't make the sort of, you know, logical leap then what newb.y should be doing. And I feel like defending that tier 1 was almost completely pointless. Sure, they didn't know that Tidehunter had Blink. They should have known that he was getting close. Maybe it was a possibility. They'll find him now in the jungle, though. 4-5-6, yeah. Scouts him out. Tidehunter drops. That's pretty easy. But
this is the thing. They have the potential, if the Axe gets the initiation, to burst on anyone the Axe catches at the start. Now, I think you're right, because the Jugger had the Aegis, they shouldn't have defended. But if he doesn't, let's say they catch the Jugger or the Quap or even the Tide, and kill them before they do anything, I think maybe they can win the fight, even though they have weaker team fights. If it's 5 versus 4 from the start, it's maybe possible.
That's a good Fisher down onto the Night Stalker. He turns back to fight, but he can't get any right clicks out. Sparrow dropping low. Omni Slash jumps to Creeps. Who's going to die first? Phoenix, Night Stalker battling it out, but it looks like Axe might be the one to die. Queen of Pain with a Sonic Wave across him. Supernova. Night Stalker is going to be super salty.
Yeah, that's really funny. It's like a little game of cat and mouse. The Nightstalker turns around, they're both on really low HP. He just wants to get that last nuke off, and the Phoenix says,
nuh-uh.
Welcome to the egg.
Okay, it's like, yeah, I'm gonna avoid you, I'm gonna finish you off, and then nope, not gonna happen. So MK, Murr, and Piao, the last ones remaining. Trying to hold out this mid lane. They've still got their jungle available, so it's not like they're completely shut out here. The big worry is, though, Juggernaut. Once he gets to this stage, with Mask of Madness Manta, he's difficult to kill, can pop out of the silence from Nightstalker, can still spin, Omni Slash, jump around in these teamfights or engagements, and he pushes out lanes pretty fast as well. He pushes the lane, goes back to farming jungle, and Roshan, when do you respawn? We'll find out in 50 seconds.
Yeah, and they're going to get it, right? They're going to get the next rush like they got the first one. And then at that stage, they're pushing tier 2s, maybe even tier 3s and Raxes. And it becomes very difficult for newb.y to just say, oh, we're not going to defend. It's pointless to defend. Well, might as well just sit in your fountain then, right? They don't have, I don't think they have the heroes to split push. They can look for pickoffs, but once the enemy team's all grouped up, if they're going for an important objective, you kind of have to do something.
You do indeed. Xiao Xiao has his BKB done. Used earlier on in that fight, down to 9 seconds now. But Whitewash, Sol Rings and Tranquils, he's running around warding everything. Does he place his... Oh, there's his own. There's his own wards. Kind of interesting seeing an observer ward placed there while you've got one watching the ancient camps as well. But they're definitely starting to prioritize Roshan. They know it's up soon, so they've all grouped up around Tidehunter ready with the Ravage. And they'll pop their heads in. Not quite up yet. newb.y have the same inclination, though. With BKB being built up on SCC, the Scarath Mage, not too much to his name right now. 1500 gold, but no big items coming out. Sniper, what's his progression like? Mask of Madness, Sand and Yasha, and now a BKB for him. But you look at the jug! Scotty! 25 minutes in. Not too bad for him, huh?
Yeah. I'm just interested in this Queen of Pain, though. Rushing the BKB is something we rarely see these days. And she just generally seems underfarmed. Her net worth is behind her last hits, if you go back to the last hits, compared to the sniper she laned against. I mean, you said earlier he was like nearly doubling up, but that was when he was at like 40 and she was at 20, and he's actually kept that ratio. A Queen of Pain's a hero that actually doesn't struggle to flash farm, can keep getting farm up, so I think she's just... I don't know if they deprioritized her when the Tide was getting farm for his Blink or something like that, but she's definitely fallen a bit behind. She's starting to catch up a bit now. But
They definitely stopped her being like farm priority too, because when you think about it, you know, Juggernaut is 1, Queen of Pain is 2. That's the regular rules for mid. Queen of Pain was 2 for like 7 or 8 minutes or something like that. Got her maybe 10 minutes. You know, got her BKB with the residual gold she had. Juggernaut still at that 1. Tidehunter building up to Blink Dagger, but then you've got to look at Earthshaker and Phoenix. Phoenix has been given a decent amount of farm. Earthshaker now needs his Blink, so his farm priority is probably going to jump up ahead of that of the Tidehunter. Or do they want him to get a pipe, because he's bought up a cloak?
I'm not too sure, but really what I was leading into is that I think that rushing the BKB on Queen of Pain makes sense if this is what happens in terms of farm. If you're only going to have that one item for all these crucial early fights, it should be a BKB, I think. I think if she only had an Orchid here, or only had an Aghanim Scepter here, she'd be so vulnerable to just being picked off. As it stands, she can only really be picked off if Lion catches her before she BKBs, or if Axe catches her. But she can't just, like, beforehand, if she didn't have a BKB, if she went into a fight with, say, an Orchid, then at any point in the fight, Nightstalker can turn around, void silence, and then just say, hey guys, Lion, just cast a spell, or Sniper, hit her twice, or something like that.
Hits her twice and she's dead. Oh, I hate that feeling. It feels like I need to sneeze, but I know it's not going to happen. Right, I've got my hand on the mute button, so I'm ready. I'm ready if I sneeze. Shrapnels drop down into the roach pit, so they know exactly what's going on around there. Terrorblade have been... They've been walking around, these three heroes, Phoenix, Earthshaker, and Tide, have been standing on this ramp for a good couple of minutes. Queen of Pain pushed out the bot lane, Juggernaut heads towards mid and pushes out that. Are they just going to smoke? Do they have a smoke, actually? Dire. No smoke. No smoke at all. They're just going to wander their way in.
Looks like it, and I mean... We've spoken so much about how their team fights stronger. I think that's why they're confident to do this. Although we also spoke about Axe getting the initiation being important and...
Oh, Link call. Jug caught out. Earthspike and Ravage the counter. Juggernaut, can he stay alive? Looks like he can! Omnislash down. They've taken down two and Scarlet Mage now is in a rough spot. The Supernova won't land on anyone as Piao with a BKB decides to turn and fight. But the Tidehunter looks like he's perfectly fine. Ahead.
Yeah,
ahead,
the Juggernaut's Scotty pickup making the difference there. Because before he had that Scotty, he's dead to the call and the Skyath and Lion ulties. And there he survived just long enough to get his ulti off and convincingly winning the fight as a result. He's just too farmed at this point.
Yep, Omni Slash, Healing Ward. And then you get your life still back from that Mask of Madness. So Roshan going in the way of Terrorblade as well as a team fight win for them. Axe a hero, you know, we've talked about snowballing Queen of Pain, talked about Nightstalker needing a good early start. But Axe in the one role. He is the epitome of a snowball hero. You need a lot of items, you need a lot of momentum, and just keep on, you know, plowing through your opponents, taking towers, pushing up onto high ground, finding pickoffs, smoking constantly. What are we looking at smoke-wise? Yeah, permanently on cooldown for the Radiant. Who's holding on to them, though? Have they used them all? Looks like they have.
Yes, they must have. Well, Nightstalker gets a BKB, Sniper's got his BKB, Axe is heading towards the BKB as well, and then the counter initiation of the Tidehunter Ravage or the Earthshaker Fissure is not going to affect them as much. But they still have this question to deal with how do they burst down the Juggernauts in the call initiation? They couldn't get it right there. And if they can't do that, and he gets Omni Slash off, how do they win the fight?
Do you just consider ignoring him? Especially now he's got Aegis Immortal, you kind of have to in these fights. Dodging fights for Newbee.Y though. They'd love to dodge 5 versus 5s. They'd love to go and smoke into the jungle. They'd love to go and take tier 2 towers. But I just do not think any of these things are possible at this moment in time. Terrorblade have taken a pretty strong handle on this game. Well, they've got a fight down at the rune spot. Xiao Xiao, there's the pickup they were looking for. Queen of Pain getting a little bit antsy, looking for that rune down at bot. She did pick it up. Bounty rune, not worth your death, though.
Yeah, and that's the hero they can kill at this point. That's the hero they all want to go on if they do get forced to fight. But if the whole team is there and they go on the Queen of Pain, even if they kill her, it might not be enough.
Oh. BKB, Sparrow, okay.
Yeah.
Out of position a little bit there. The rest of his team were looping around up on this high ground, but Newbee.Y were ready for it.
And there's going to be a little frustration on the side of Terrorblade at these two pickoffs, because I think that there'll be a sense that if we just stick together, they can't do that to us. Like, why are we all split up like this? You know, we've got the Aegis. What are we waiting for? Can we just group up and push, guys? Because that's exactly what newb.Y want to happen right now. You know, these small pickoffs that keep delaying the push, that keep giving them time to make the Sniper stronger and stronger, because Sniper's ultimately their late game plan, right? It's just the Sniper.
And giving BKB to the Axe as well, he was quite a distance away from it, but with these two kills, he picks it up right now. I think Juggernaut pushing top lane with the Aegis the Immortal, you know, he's pretty safe up there. Killing him twice is pretty hard, especially if you can turn around and Mask Madness, Omni Slash, Mantis style out of things. He can split push pretty deftly up on top while the other four heroes group up. And force like what you said, you know, force Newbee to fight 5 versus 4, have the Juggernaut run in, his movement speed is through the roof with Mask of Madness and Phase Boots. He can sprint towards the fight pretty quickly. He's slowed down and taking a little bit of a harass here from the Skywrath Mage. But, yeah.
He doesn't care.
He really doesn't care at all. Axe, if he had managed to get in there with a blink call, then maybe he would have cared. But here's the 5-man group.
Maybe they were waiting, because Queen of Pain is getting pretty close to Hex, and Earthshaker is getting pretty close to Dagger. But it does seem like, yeah, they've reacted to those pickoffs with the right mentality of, we just need to group up, we can't get picked off altogether, and if they go on the Queen of Pain, even if they kill her, I do think that the rest of the team just wins the fight there, if all the important spells get committed to the Queen of Pain.
What are they looking for? What are they looking for? Darkness has popped. Earth Spike not gonna land. Tide is ready.
Look at what Sniper bought, a Ghost Scepter.
That's nice. That's me. Nice. Ravage goes on a Sniper. Sonic Wave as well across two. Supernova now gonna land. BKB popping the Sniper at the very end of his lifespan. Axe does manage to find a kill onto Phoenix, but what's left? What's remaining here for Newbee.Y? Three heroes down, Axe dropping low, and it looks like he will die to the Juggernaut, swiping him down. A few more hits, a few more crits, Anchor Smash will take him out, but Lion looks for the kill back onto Tide. He drops low, but it'll take another couple of hits, and the Void. Nice Stalker to finish him off. Aegis the Immortal is still up, though. Lion, where are you going? Earthspike off cooldown, but you can't put it out. 4-5-6 with one Void remaining, turns back, he's got to fight, he's got to do something, because he cannot run from this Juggernaut. Marauding through their ranks.
Yeah, and what a sign of desperation it is, where I was talking about how this game's going late. It's not what Newbee.Y wanted. Sniper's gonna be the only thing that really scales them well into the late game, and he's bought a Ghost Scepter. Anyway, it's a sign of how desperate things feel for Newbee.Y right now.
Oh yeah, definitely. Even that, you know, throwing Mystic Flare onto a target that can just run away from it. They've taken down the melee racks and they'll back themselves up. There's no need to push in too hard. You can go back and farm Ancients, farm the Radiant Jungle if you so desire. Earthshaker? That's pretty nice for him. 34 minutes in, the 5-roll ES finds himself a dagger.
I mean, I'm just trying to think. So Sniper wants to Ghost Scepter when he's being Omni-Slashed, right? Mm-hmm. The issue is that, sure, the Juggernaut's not doing the damage in the Omni-Slash, but then the Sniper's also not doing damage. And I think the Sniper's team actually is starting to depend more on his damage than the Juggernaut's team is depending on his. You know, they've got the ES dagger, the Tide dagger, Phoenix ulti, Queen of Pain and all her damage with now a Hex as well. I understand, yeah, it's better than dying to the Omni-Slash, but yes. It's... That's why I call it a move of desperation, because it doesn't actually, like... It helps you not die in a certain way, but it doesn't give you like a long-term or ultimate plan for how you actually win that fight.
It's 1600 gold that's spent on an item to help you survive against one facet of Terrorblade's team fight, the Omni-Slash. But then you look at Hex on Xiao Xiao. Sure enough, the Sonic Wave with the pure damage doesn't get amplified by the Ghost Scepter, so he's not going to worry about any extra magic damage coming out of that. There isn't too much magic damage, you know, from Terrorblade, so it is just the Omni-Slash he'll save himself from, and there's no real negative factors there. But then if you look at his actual itemization himself, Ghost Scepter to deal with Omni-Slash, okay. But then he's got BKB, which will, you know, dispel the Ghost Scepter and then make him take Omni-Slash damage. Then the Mask of Mana, Sanjin Yasha, and Crit. You said it pretty clearly. He cannot do damage while in Ghost Scepter form.
Yeah, so in a way, his Ghost Scepter counters all his other items. It counters himself.
It is counterintuitive to pick it up, pretty much. Counterproductive. Counter everything.
I think, yeah, I sort of feel like Sniper just needs to find a better way to not be in a position where he gets Omni-Slash. It's hard, though. The Juggernaut has a Blink Dagger. But I mean, the whole point is that the composition is just difficult. With these lineups, I just feel like Newbee.Y wanted to snowball. They didn't snowball, and now they're confused. They're not sure what to do.
Well, they spot someone. They see them coming in now with the Observer Ward. Xiao Xiao's in Viz. They don't see him. Hex now revealed as Piao dropped to half HP. Has to run. Has to get out. Ravage does catch a couple, but the BKBs from the Radiant allowing them to battle through it as SCC gets the call down onto the Jug, slams him into the ground with a big old dunk. Queen of Pain is fighting Piao in the back lines. Ghost Scepter does save him, though, from a few right clicks here. Xiao Xiao gets turned on. And the fight continues in the back. Tidehunter now gets called and taken. Terrorblade losing 4-1. Whitewash will finally bring down Piao's sniper. But
I think that Tidehunter's Ravage hit zero people. I think they all BKB'd, all three of them. Am I right?
It definitely missed out on all of the BKB targets. So the three BKBs completely whiffed on them. I think it hit the Skywrath or Lion. I'm not sure, though.
Well, so let's assume it did. I'd know for sure that if it hit the Lion, he had already used Hex. Because that's how they killed the Juggernaut. Juggernaut got hexed, and then he got called. And remember last time we said they don't have the damage to kill the Juggernaut when they call him? Well, they definitely have the damage to kill him with the hex and the call. That's enough disable, and the sniper was able to do some of the hitting there as well. Sure, the sniper went down, but fight going terribly wrong for Terrorblade in a situation where we were just talking about how it's so difficult for the fight to go terribly wrong for them. But they did go in one at a time, and really ineffectively, the Juggernaut doesn't get ulti off. The Tyranta gets a pretty irrelevant ulti off. And Queen of Pain can't carry everything on her shoulders.
The thing is, though, the Queen of Pain bossed everything on the sniper. She jumped in onto the sniper, hexed him, screamed him, sonic waved him, and then they had pretty much no AoE magical damage or pure damage to spread out onto anyone else. So with the BKBs up for Nightstalker and the Axe, Ravage did nothing. Sonic Wave wasn't available, so they couldn't get that spread of pure across them. And what's left? Juggernaut's dead. Your damage output is now limited to Earthshaker with Enchant Totem.
It's just a little bit of recklessness in general, because I think the Juggernaut, especially with a Blink Dagger, in addition to the Manta Star, he's not meant to get caught out by Lion's Hex that easily, in a position where he can get hexed and then called. And I think that Terrorblade are just feeling like, we're so strong they can't do anything, we'll just like YOLO a bit at them. But certainly after losing that fight, they'll be aware of like, okay, this is what not to do, this is the way that we could lose a fight. And they go into the rush pit, get another Aegis, and that fight doesn't happen with an Aegis. And there's a cheese Nazi.
Oh yeah, that's the thing though, their win condition for team fight still hasn't changed from, you know, 10 minutes in when I was mentioning they want to fight around towers. They want to fight in choke points, places where they force Newbee.Y to be the ones sitting around and defending. If Newbee.Y are the ones that, you know, they broke out from their tier 2 at bot. They broke out into their jungle, then they get spread. You know, there's all these heroes around, they've got BKBs. That was the perfect positioning for Newbee.Y. Whereas Terrorblade, they've got to try and, okay, say, we've got this target over here, that target over there. If I Ravage, I've got to blink into the middle of them. Then they pop BKBs. There's no real focus for Terrorblade unless there's a tower here and Newbee.Y have to sit and defend behind it.
I do think that this Tidehunter needs to make a conscious effort to get at least one of the cores in his Ravage. And that either means catching them before BKB or waiting out the BKBs and going late. I don't think it's at all worth it to blow Ravage just to hit the supports, even if he hits both supports.
Well, Terrorblade still have a pretty decent pushing high ground squad. One Rax was already taken, you know, so they've still got this advantage, even if the net worth graph does show Newbee.Y bringing it back pretty heavily, dropping the 7,500 net worth lead Terrorblade had down to about 2.5k. Experience they actually bring back into their sector. 2.5k lead over to Newbee.Y. Juggernaut dropping low. Ancient Seal and Mystic Flare popping the Manta late. Takes him pretty low on HP.
Yeah, but Mystic Flare is now cooling down, and that's part of the damage output they used to kill him, actually. And I keep wondering, is Tyranta going to try catch anyone before BKB, or is he just waiting it out? He seems like he's considering it.
That's who I'm looking for right now. Tyranta and Axe. Who blinks first? Because if Axe gets a good blink call onto a couple of people, pops his BKB beforehand, that's an opening for Newbee.Y to say, okay, we've got the fight in our hands. BKB Sniper, BKB Nightstalker, run in and take him out. But it matters a lot who he gets that call on.
Yeah, it's going to happen this wave. I have a strong feeling.
There we go. They find the jug, they'll bring down his first life. And Xiao Xiao in the back. Hex stop, double stun now down from MK. Great play by him. Tide, Ravage, not really catching too much and dunked into the ground. Xiao Xiao jumps in to try and find a counter kill, but Juggernaut is back alive. With the Omni Slash, a few hits and crits, triple kill, ultra kill. Will this be a rampage for
HM? Look at all the buybacks.
He's looking for a whole bunch more, yeah? Axe and Sniper both coming back in, but a good stun down from the Earthshaker. Locking in SCC. MK takes an Echo Slam solo to the face. Doesn't do too much damage, but now the buyback Axe battling up against this Juggernaut who's got more movement speed than God. And Xiao Xiao on the high ground. Culling Blade threshold, dropping low. Not going to get there, and he'll blink himself away. His Juggernaut diving into the base. Behind the tier 3, he's alone versus 3. He's got nothing left to give, and he gets slammed.
Yeah, so overextending in the end there. I mean, it's always one of the risks when you're the team that's pushing, the other team has buybacks. And you need to, I mean, in that position, they needed to react to the buybacks by just retreating. There's no reason to keep fighting further. Again, I think the Tyranta didn't get much value out of his Ravage. I don't know if you saw that one. He waited really long, and I think he tried to time it so that his Ravage would be right as those two BKBs ended.
Yeah.
But he did it sort of 1 second too early, and the two BKB'd people were still BKB'd. And I think he only caught one or two supports again, like the previous time. So he just needs to be a bit more patient. He was patient, but he wasn't quite patient enough.
Well, the Radiant Tier 3 tower looks pretty shocked at what happened just behind him. They've got all these faces on it. There are four faces on the Radiant Tower, and they all look pretty surprised at what was going on. Tidehunter heads back into the entrance, but the Radiant, with an Invis Axe, hasted a Lion. Wait, how did they manage the double... It must have had a double rune at 42 minutes, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Kind of like, okay, how did they manage this? But Lion's haste is running out pretty soon while the Axe Invis... Where does he head?
The buybacks in that fight were forced just by the Aegis, I think. Nothing else, really. Because, again, the Tidehunter wasn't getting the Ravage off. So, I think maybe Terrorblade now want to wait for another rush. Because they might be aware that it's the Aegis that did the work for them there. The alternative is they want to go for a fight because there won't be buybacks. And if they win a fight against no buybacks, that'll be great for them. Especially because they've got buybacks on Juggernauts and Queen of Pain. So, maybe, yeah, Juggernaut spawns, they just go again. Only issue is that if they lose the fight, buying back... when they're pushing the enemy base doesn't help as much. They don't have boots of travel on anyone. And that is why the buyback advantage is always favorable to the defending team. But yeah, they all smoke up. They're going to go for some kind of maybe first a pick off or kill attempt and then just push down a lane. Because they know now if they kill Axe or Sniper, both of those heroes can't buy back.
Well, Roshan is a long way until respawn time. Xiao Xiao, Juggernaut, played by HM. They're on the front lines. They're looking for something. Radiant, they pretty much signal out they're smoked up in our jungle. They're out
sniper,
there.
Sniper.
Do they get vision? They know he's there. Shrapnel's dropped. They know he's close by, but they're not going to get the jump. Queen of Pain. Okay, there we go. Starts things off with the X. BKB instant with a great Fissure down. Sniper down for the count. 100 seconds without your main DPS dealer as tier 3 at bot looks pretty worried right now. The heroes come in. Sunray. Not sure who that was aimed at by Sparrow, but nevertheless. Juggernaut's Illusions getting taken out one by one by MK's Mana Drain. HM jumps, called Mystic Flare, Ravage again! Not catching the BKBs, but they do take down the support in the back lines. Culling Blade from Axe actually misses out. Juggernaut not going to die. He finally falls in the final seconds of the fight. But Newbee.Y have lost four. Nightstalker, last man standing, and he doesn't offer you too much when Xiao Xiao jumps straight in.
Yeah, and at that point, Juggernaut actually had gold to buy back and get travel, so yeah. Very convincing win in the end, and well done to Terrorblade. I think newb.young's draft just not working out the way that they planned it. Definitely wanted to snowball. It started okay in the lane stage, but after that, didn't go their way.
Yeah, things got a little bit messy around 15 minutes in. The Sniper did a great job in middle lane, the Queen of Pain looking a little bit behind, but Juggernaut once again. Proving that he's a beast at farming and pushing and fighting at everything that he wants to do. But guys, stick around. We'll be back with game number 2 coming up shortly here in the VP Game Group Stage Qualifiers between newb.Y and Terrorblade. Don't go anywhere.